Billy Deck are an apostolic couple who are called to the nations. They teach, preach, heal, and deliver the Word of God wherever they go. In Paris, France, in Ghana, West Africa, in Belize, Central America, in Grenada, West Indies, in Nigeria, West Africa, in China, and in Berlin, Germany. We welcome you to the program today, and our prayer for you is that you will make Jesus Lord of all.
Morning and your joy to heaven is humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and he will lift you up. So we are to struggle against covetousness. We are not to give in to the works of the flesh and all the things he mentioned. That was quite an exhortation. And we are also to struggle against belittling others and passing judgment on our neighbors. How many of you, don't lift your hands, but how many of you today already have been challenged with this opportunity to sin by belittling others and passing judgment on our neighbors and our friends? And verse 11, the same chapter, speak not evil one of another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brethren and judges his brother speak evil of the law and judges the law. But if thou judge the law, they are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? Go now, ye that say today or tomorrow we'll go to such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? He asked the question, is it even a vapor that just appears for a little while? You look in the morning and there's the fog out there, and then you look at, when the sun comes out, you look again, it's gone. Where'd it go? It's gone. And he's saying that that's what our life is like. It's a vapor. It appears for a little while, then it vanishes away. If you just blink your eye, I said to Al the other day, you know, in the light of eternity, our life is just that. Just the blink of the eye. And we get so involved in life, and especially the hard parts of life. I'm on verse 15 now, that you... For that ye ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is evil. Wow. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. I just read from James 4, 1 through 17. Okay. Now, one of my favorite scriptures is Ephesians chapter 1. And this is Paul's prayer. It's actually his exhortation. He tells the Ephesian church who we are in Christ, and then he prays a powerful prayer. I'm going to just go through the first part of this chapter. And I really would encourage you to commit this to memory, because this is a powerful scripture, and it will help you know who you are. Did I bring the books up? Yeah. I've taken the privilege of years ago, I put a little booklet together called Who Am I? And it's all scripture about who we are. Who am I? God's answer, my confession. It's just a little pamphlet. It's all scripture. I didn't write it. I just compiled it because it's scripture. And so you can obtain that if you go to our website, www.abdeck.net, and get a copy of that and just put it in your Bible. Go through the house and confess it. That's what I did. I would just actually go through the house when I was, after I had the two automobile accidents back in 69, I would just pick one leg up in front of the other as I was learning to walk again, and I would confess who I am in Christ. I would say it out loud. I figured if there was an angel around, he would enjoy hearing it, but if there was a devil around, he wouldn't, and he would run. And so I just would say it out loud. There's nobody in the house, and I would just say, according to the word of God, I am more than a conqueror. And I would just go through the house like that. Hallelujah. I mean, I know what it is to walk by faith. I know what it is to walk on water. So I qualify to teach you because I'm still doing it. Hallelujah. It's not something you attain and you say, okay, I've got it now. I'm home free. No, you have to continue to walk that way. That's where the occupying until he comes takes place. Hallelujah. Okay, so Ephesians 1, I'll begin with verse 3. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And a watch down, I'm going to say it out loud, really out loud, the things where you're blessed. Who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. If you've got your Bible open, I encourage you to underscore these words. And that first word is blessed. Now verse 4. Accordingly, he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. There's two things there in verse 4, chosen and holy. Ooh, my word. Did you know we were chosen and holy? And verse 5, having predestined us, the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. He just did it because he wanted to. Isn't that wonderful? To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Wow. And number 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. See, Paul said in the first scripture we read about how God had made known his will to him. And listen, verse 9, he says he's made known to us the mystery of his will, to us too as well, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time he might gather together in one, how many things? All things in Christ, both those which are in heaven and those which are on earth, even in him. See, God created the heavens and the earth, and he wants to bring it together. And that my book, the newest book I've written called Third Day Intercession, Prophetic Third Day Intercession, and I'm teaching you how to bring heaven to earth. Amen. It's pretty exciting. Yeah, we're on verse 11. We have obtained an inheritance, he says. We have an inheritance in whom we have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his will. We just read all of that. That's wonderful. And then in verse 13, he says that we are sealed. Isn't it wonderful? How are we sealed? We're sealed by the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit comes to seal us. That and it says that the Holy Spirit is the earnest or the down payment of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession into the praise of his glory. Okay, so you have received. Say, I have received a great inheritance.
I have received a great inheritance.
There's power and boldness in Jesus Christ.
Power and boldness in Jesus.
He lives big in me.
He's
the one who gives me life. Now, in this world, you're going to have opportunities to live under, but God wants you to live over, above, and beyond, right, Papa? Why does he want us to do that? Because he's already bought and paid for it. When Jesus did this, he stretched himself out. He paid the price for our abundant life, right? It's not something we have to pay. We have to accept it, receive it, accept it, and obey his words. It's so important to do our part, but he's already done his part. You don't sit down until the job's done. And after he finished, you know, he was dead, buried, raised, now elevated to the heavens, seated again at the right hand of God, ever living to make intercession for us. He's right there now. He's intercede for us. When the enemy comes to accuse us, then Jesus is our advocate. He's our lawyer. He's interfering for us. He's pleading our case before the Father. Isn't that wonderful? And he's interceding for us. Isn't that wonderful? You have an intercessor. Sometimes I feel like nobody's praying for me, and I'll say, Jesus, pray for me. He said, I am. I'm praying for you. When no one else is praying, you got to learn to pray for yourself, too. Don't just wait for somebody else to pray for you. Learn to pray for yourself. Learn to declare the word. Learn the word. Learn what the word is and learn to declare it. Now, that scripture I gave you right there, that's enough to last you till the Lord comes. Just declare that every day, who you are. Say that out loud. and take this little book if you want to. It'll help you a little more. But that scripture right there in Ephesians chapter 1, wonderful, wonderful, wonderful scripture. So in this world, we need to learn to live above oppression and to walk in joy and peace. That's how we will draw people to Him. It's when they see our lifestyle, that we're living above it. It's like I tell Al, every time the enemy tries to hit me with something, it's like the people are going, well, let's see how she gets through this one. Because they're watching you, you know. They are. They're watching you to see how you're going to get through it. And we always do. Look, we just come through another big one. Huh? Here we are. Every need met, being healthy and prospering as our soul prospers. So confess this with me. I will ascend and walk in the pathway of destiny that God has chosen for me. Now, if you're walking in disobedience and contrary to the will and word of God, He loves you, but you won't have the blessing that you would have if you're walking in obedience. Amen? Just don't go through the motions of serving God. You must make your decision to follow Christ and to make the decision to be in His presence and to be in the presence of people who can raise you up to the higher level of greatness. That's why you're here, isn't it? Amen. You came to get a, you didn't come to get a fix. Like, you know, addicts have to have their daily fix or however often they get a fix. But you came to get another level of glory so that you can continue in your ascent, right? Lift your hands and say, I'm an ascending woman. I'm going from glory to glory. Oh, shut up, Akaya. I'm going from strength to strength. Thank you, Lord. Whoa, hallelujah. Out there on TV land, on the internet, are you ascending today? Are you ascending today? God, I'm inviting you to ascend. So don't just make the motions. Let's go ahead and ascend. When we moved into the suburbs of Northern Virginia, we moved from Memphis. I was just a young matron raising three active children, and I was struggling with joint problems of three varieties. After the birth of the last child, I began to have arthritis in three different areas of levels of my body. And I met one of our neighbors who lived across the street. She was a very gifted woman, and she invited me to go with her to another lady's home where they were going to have a concert. There were two, when I got there, the dining room had been turned into a concert hall, and there were two grand pianos, if you could visualize this, in the dining room, two grand pianos. And so they played duets in semi-concert style. I found that they were both struggling with challenges with their husbands and particularly their husband's health. Over the years, they had both become fast friends, and each time I was in their presence, I felt lifted up. Because remember, I was just a young matron struggling with these three children, didn't have a lot of outreach except through church. I wanted to model my life after theirs. As we lived there in that neighborhood over the years, the one continued to be my neighbor just across the street, but the other one moved to another neighborhood. And we would meet through Christian women's organizations from time to time, and she often played the piano even when I was guest speaker at organizations later on. Then she began to attend the Tuesday morning women's Bible study when we opened our home for meetings in the mid-70s. Later, she left the Methodist church and began to attend the church that we attended and were leading intercession. And she began to attend those classes as well. When her husband passed away, she was in the nursing home next to the church. She came to the weekly Bible studies. And many times, she would play the piano at those weekly Bible studies in the nursing home. Our paths crossed many times in those 45 years, and we grew closer in our walk. She actually wrote a song for our ministry, the Cedars of Lebanon. But the neighbor moved off to the Midwest to be near her son. Last month, she had a stroke, and the outcome was grim. Her daughter now lives in the house she grew up in across from us. She called to ask us to pray for her mom. Al prayed with her at the time, and we prayed later. Before we left to come even to the next meeting we were going to, Holly called us to say that her mom had woke up from the coma she was in after the stroke, and she had told the doctor that she was ready to go home. This was right before Christmas. She's ready to go home for the holidays. So God is faithful to the faithful. He cannot deny his own. But those two women really made an impact on my life early in those days. And then later on, God used me to make an impact in their lives. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? So the seed that you plant, you know, you never know how God is going to bring it to maturity and even to turn it around to bring glory to himself and to minister to the body of Christ. Isn't that a sweet story? I would like to share with us today 7 steps now to ascending, to be an ascending woman and to walking into our destiny, okay? Number 1, know that God has destined your life. Romans 8:29. Is a good scripture there, but I'm going to read to you from Jeremiah. I knew you in your mother's womb. He said, I know the plans I have for you. They're good and not evil. But he says, I knew you in the mother's womb. I'm paraphrasing this. Remember, Jesus was the firstborn of many brethren. He's our elder brother. He walked as a pattern son. He's our model, our pattern that we're to follow. But God looks upon you even while you're being formed. We have 3 right now in the womb, 3 great-grands right now. One's due in November, one's due in March, and one's due in May. And so right now, God is looking upon them while they're being formed in the inner parts, you know. Nowadays, they can take these little, what do you call them, pictures of them in the womb. I can't think of the word of it now. Sonogram. Thank you, Darren. And so we can see even what they look like. We saw that Daniel's little Connor looked like Daniel before he was ever born. We can see the nose and the face and everything, and to see that that little boy had the image of his father planted on him. Whew. It's amazing. But God is watching upon us while we're being formed, even in the mother's womb. He has that desire. He has that ability to look at us, even before he gave man the ability to look with the sonogram. Amen? Isn't that neat? And Jesus, being our elder brother, says the things I do, you will do, and even greater. Have you done the greater things yet? Have you even done the things Jesus did yet? I have to go back and say, well, wait a minute, Jesus. I've healed the sick. I've cast out devils. I've raised the dead. I've done a lot of the things, but I haven't walked on water yet. I haven't turned water to wine. There's a lot of things he did I haven't done yet. But now he says, you're going to even do greater things than I did. I say, wow. Wow. That's a big wow. So he said, the reason I do it is because the reason you're going to do that is because I'm going to go to the Father. I can't be here with you, but I'm going to go to the Father. It's necessary. He told the disciples, don't be sad I'm going away. It's necessary for you that I go away in order for him to come, the third part of the Trinity. If I go, then he can come, the Holy Spirit. Praise God. We don't hear enough about the Holy Spirit. Amen. The work of the Holy Spirit is so important. When he left, he sent the blessed Holy Spirit, whose work is to teach us and train us and comfort us, bring us to maturity. Amen? If we submit to him, if we submit to the Word, remember, he's the one that is the author of the Word. He's the one that inspired men to write these wonderful epistles that we have in the Bible, and to decree and to record, even in the Old Testament, all those wonderful writings in the Old Testament and then in the New. He reminds us of every word Jesus said and guides us into all truth. For me, that's one of the most important works of the Holy Spirit, is that he guides us into truth. There is so much false doctrine out there today. There is so much error. And if you have the Holy Spirit in you, as you hear, even as you hear me speak, God will quicken what I'm saying to you. You will know. Your spirit will bear witness with what I say, whether it's truth or error. Amen? So if you have the Holy Spirit living in you out there in TV land, in internet land, if you have the Holy Spirit, and if you don't, ask him right now and he'll come and fill you. Yesterday I forgot to ask people to come to Jesus. And if you haven't accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, do it right now. Say, Lord Jesus, I confess my sin. I thank you. I accept you as the Lord and Savior of my life. I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died for me, that you shed your blood for me, that you covered my sin. You take them away. And now I believe in you and ask you, I receive you. Come into my heart and my life. Change me, Lord, change me. And let me live forever with you. And then you can ask the Holy Spirit, Come, Holy Spirit. Infuse me. Fill me. Overflow me. Teach me. Train me. All these things we're talking about now. And this is one of the most powerful works of the Holy Spirit, that he reminds us of the words of Jesus. When we read the epistles and the recordings of Jesus' works and his words, I remember when I went to heaven, the Lord said to me, 3 days later, I'm just still laying in the bed. I'm still in the afterglow of that experience of being there for 4.5 hours. I'm just laying there. I can't speak. All I can do is just lay there. And I just thought, Lord, what was that? You took a coal from the altar and you put it on my lips. What was that for? I just thought that. And immediately the answer came. Remember, God is a spirit and he communicates to us through our spirit. And he said to me, that's for how I'm going to use you in the days to come. To speak, to decree, to declare, to preach, to pray, to prophesy, and to proclaim my word, my will, and my ways.
Amen.
My word, my will, and my ways. That's what God wants us to use our mouth to do. Not to gossip or complain or judge, but to use our word to decree and declare his word, his will, and his ways. And this is what the Holy Spirit does. Every time we read the epistles of Jesus' words, then the Holy Spirit reminds us of those words. So you're out witnessing it at the mall or at Walmart or at school or at the office, and all of a sudden you open your mouth and there's somebody, and here the word starts coming out of your mouth, and then you go back to your office or you get in your car and you're leaving, you go, what did I say? What did I do? It was the Holy Ghost using that scripture right there to bring up into your memory every word that Jesus spoke, and then you're speaking it under the unction of the Holy Spirit, because God has already prepared that heart. He's prepared those people who are ready for you, and so you deposit that word like seed. You're planting seed. Hallelujah. Then he'll bring somebody else to water it. Then he'll bring the increase. Isn't it wonderful? It's so easy when we do our part, when each one of us does our part. As Paul said, we fitly join together. Amen. We're talking about women. We have opportunities to do this every day. Women and men, both, children, even children at school. Hallelujah. So, Acts 1:8. We have the power source. That's the Holy Spirit. The power source is the Holy Spirit to overcome and to infuse us to walk out God's plans for our life. Okay, number two, you have a choice. Say, I have a choice. Joshua 2:24-15. Choose you this day whom you will serve. You've got to learn to swim upstream and not to go back. Everyone will not go in the direction that God has called you to go. Everyone will not lock into your destiny. It's your choice. Each person has a choice. All right. Number three, refuse to settle for nothing less than what it costs for your destiny. Last night I left the tags on my outfit, because I pull them out and I say, everything has a price. You got to learn to pay the price. You got to learn to accept the fact that it's going to cost you something. It cost Jesus something, didn't it? It cost him his life. And you think you're any better than him? It will cost you your life. Philippians 3:12. I follow after that I might apprehend. I lay hold upon what Jesus has for my life. And verse 14, I press for the mark of the high calling. You have a higher calling, not just salvation and baptism, but you have a high calling, a high calling. The high calling is, if God has called you to be truly like Jesus in all your spirit, he will draw you into a life of crucifixion and humility. He will put on you such demands of obedience. Guys, listen to this, because I read this often, it helps me. He will put on you such demands of obedience that you will not be allowed to follow other Christians. In many ways, he seems to let other good people do things which he will not let you do. Others who seem to be very religious and useful may push themselves, pull wires, schemes to carry out their plans, but you can't do that. If you attempt it, you will meet with such failure and rebuke from the Lord as to make you sorely penitent. Others can brag about themselves, their work, their successes, their writings, but the Holy Ghost will not allow you to do any such thing. If you begin to do so, he will lead you into such deep mortification that it will make you despise yourself and all your good works. Others will be allowed to succeed in making great sums of money or having a legacy left to them. or having luxuries. But God may supply you only on a day-to-day basis, because he wants you to have something far better than gold, a helpless dependence on him and his unseen treasury. The Lord may let others be honored and put forth while keeping you in hidden obscurity, because he wants to produce some choice, fragrant fruit for his coming glory, which can only be produced in the shade. God may let others be great, but keep you small. He will let others do a work for him and get the credit, but he will make you work and toil without knowing how much you're doing. Then to make your work still more precious, he will let others get credit for the work which you did. This to teach you the message of the cross, humility, and something of the value of being cloaked with his nature. The Holy Spirit will put a strict watch on you, and with a jealous love rebuke you for careless words and feelings, or for wasting your time, which other Christians never seem to be distressed over. So make up your mind that God is infinite, sovereign, and has a right to do what he pleases with his own, and that he may not explain to you 1,000 things which may puzzle you and your reasoning in his dealings with you. God will take you at your word if you absolutely sell yourself to be his slave. He will wrap you up in a jealous love and let other people say and do things that you can't do. Settle it forever. You are to deal directly with the Holy Spirit. He is to have the privilege of tying your tongue, chaining your hand, closing your eyes in ways others are not dealt with. However, know this great secret of the kingdom: when you are so completely possessed with the living God that you are, in your secret heart, pleased and delighted over this peculiar, personal, private, jealous guardianship and management of the Holy Spirit over your life, you will have found the vestibule of heaven, the high calling of God.
Thank you for being with us today. We believe that the word you have heard will work mightily in you and bring you into a closer walk with Jesus Christ. If you have not asked him into your life, why not do it now? Romans 10:13 says, "Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." And visit our website for helps in your growth. Our website is www.abdeck.org. And write us at Jesus is Lord, Al and Billie Deck, Cedars of Lebanon, Inc., P.O. Box 523-077, Springfield, Virginia, 22152, USA. Books and tapes are available of this program upon request and a love gift. Please mention the date and subject of the program. Until next time, we say, Jesus is Lord of all.